It is a common misconception about ancient Egypt that slaves were used to construct the pyramids. However, recent archaeological evidence has shown that this is not the case. Instead, it is now believed that either farmers built the pyramids when flooding prevented them from working on their lands, or that a workforce of laborers dedicated their entire lives to the task of constructing the pyramids. That is not to suggest that slavery did not exist in ancient Egypt, because it did. Nevertheless, the practice of slavery in ancient Egypt was not quite the same as how we believe it to be now. There is no exact equivalent for the word slave in ancient Egypt. Nevertheless, there are references to those who were bonded for life and were known as squire angs, which suggests that slavery of some kind did exist in ancient Egypt, despite the fact that there is no evidence of a legal code in ancient Egypt that outlawed slavery. Some Egyptologists, such as Antonio Lopriano, have proposed that the term slavery may refer to a socio-economic dependency rather than a legal status. This is despite the fact that it may not directly translate to the modern understanding of slavery. However, he also acknowledged the existence of coerced labor prisoners of war and the restriction of individual freedom for certain individuals all throughout ancient Egypt. He argues that the virtual absence of legally codified slavery in a society that is so focused on written documentation cannot be coincidence. However, he admits that this was a reality in ancient Egypt. We also do not know whether or not slaves were expected to work their entire lives. There is a possibility that slaves and others who were forced to work were given the promise of freedom or even were set free throughout the course of their lives, although there's little evidence to support this. Chattel slavery, bonded labor, chattee slavery, and forced labor were the four types of slavery that were practiced throughout Egypt's history. If we define slavery in the context of ancient Egypt as unpaid labor or work that is forced upon a person, then there are four types of slavery that existed during that time period. Now, let's take a more in-depth look at each of them, beginning with the first one. Chattel slavery. Those who were sold as chattel slaves were mostly prisoners of war, people who had committed illegal crimes, or people who were born into the life of a slave mother. Documented evidence of expeditions to kidnap Libyan and Nubian citizens and compel them into slavery as prisoners of war dates all the way back to the reign of Sneferi in the Old Kingdom period of ancient Egypt, which lasted from 2600 to 2200 BC. These chattel slaves were regarded as royal resources that were under the pharaoh's jurisdiction. The pharaoh had the option of resettling them by relocating them to labor colonies, donating them to temples, or giving them as gifts to persons who could assist earn political favor. This practice lasted until the Middle Kingdom, which saw a rise in the prevalence of Asian slavery. However, if these persons had originated from a place other than Libya or Nubia, they might have been freed from their servitude once a certain amount of time had passed. Bonded labor. In ancient Egypt, it was not uncommon for someone to voluntarily sell themselves into slavery. This typically took place when a person was in too much debt to pay off on their own, and as a final act of desperation, they would sell themselves and their children into slavery in order to pay off their debt. It was possible for someone at any level of ancient Egyptian society to find themselves in this situation. Nonetheless, peasants were more likely to sell themselves outright in exchange for food and shelter. During the first intermediate period and the Middle Kingdom era of ancient Egypt of 2181 to 1650 BC, women were frequently victims of this sort of slavery. This was especially prevalent during the first intermediate period. Chattee slaves. These ancient Egyptians, like those forms many other ancient civilizations, were very interested in the ideas of gods and the afterlife. Some people who believed that their time on earth was just one part of their journey and that in the afterlife they would reclaim all that they had lost were so desperate to guarantee their place in the afterlife that they willingly became a sort of bondage slave known as chattee. Others believed that their time on earth was just one part of their journey and that in the afterlife they would reclaim all they had lost. The reason we say kind of is because historians are unsure of where chattee originated, and some evidence suggests that they had slightly more choice and freedom than a standard bonded slave would have. This is why they say sort of. Women were almost likely paid, although males were not. But being a Shabti meant being promised a place in the afterlife, which according to some historians would have been considered recompense enough at the time. Forced labor. Corvi labor refers to employment that is either unpaid or forced, and was used by the ancient Egyptian government to recruit laborers from the general populace. This may be anything from military expeditions to acquire additional chattel slaves, mining and quarrying operations, construction projects, or whatever else the state decided it required assistance with. This is also the origin of the misconception that slaves were responsible for building the pyramids. Despite this, it has been demonstrated that this is not the case, as we have discussed earlier. They were not slaves in the classic sense because they were not owned by anybody, yet they were not paid for their work because it was no obligation to the state. Conscripted employees were not considered slaves in the traditional sense. Those who were promised payments, as it did, occur in some circumstances, but very rarely saw the pay actually materialize, those who were paid. It is believed that during the time of the Old Kingdom, all serfs were required to perform corvi labor and could have been called upon by the state at any time. The only exceptions to this rule were members of the protected upper classes, which included Egyptian royalty, nobility, and the descendants of these groups. Antonio Lorenzo, a historian, says that in the period of the Middle Kingdom, forced slavery was characterized as servants are defined as men but treated like property. It would appear that the radicalization of forced labor that began around the end of the Old Kingdom has now achieved its zenith in terms of shifting patterns of economic redistribution. Poorer households would borrow grains from richer field owners, and if they were unable to repay the loan, the amount that had been borrowed would gradually consign family members, particularly women, to involuntary service in the owner's household. There was also an appearance of the definition of royal laborer. These slaves belonged to the state and had been acquired through a military campaign or through trade. They were viewed as having the same status as the Asian slaves that were also prominent in ancient Egypt. The Asian slaves performed a variety of household and other tasks, such as working in the fields and gardens, weaving and serving in the households. A slave's life. Ancient Egyptian society did not maintain a separate class of slaves from the rest of the population, according to historian Dr. Andrew Hovek's explanation. They did not exist as a distinct social class because they were integrated into the local populace. He asserted that they were handled in the same manner as free people and provided evidence that slaves had married Egyptian women. There was also the customary divide between owners and slaves, with masters having the ability to put their slaves to work in household and manual labor, as well as teach them a trade or craft so that they may become more valuable. Historians have discovered evidence that between the time of the New Kingdom and the Third Intermediate Period of 1550 to 664 BC, slaves in Egypt had the ability to become citizens of the country, possess property, and enjoy some legal protections. As a direct consequence of this, the status of individuals brought in as forced prisoners of war in the New Kingdom and the Third Intermediate was subtly modified. Despite the fact that these existed, an increasing number of people came as self-slaves, signing themselves up so they could enter Egypt in the hope of a better life, to receive living quarters and food where otherwise they would have had none, or to honor the concept of Shabti and the granted admittance to work in the afterlife. These people came to Egypt in the hope of a better life. Historians have discovered evidence indicating that these slaves felt they could escape from their masters provided they had a valid reason for doing so. However, actual cases in which this occurred have not truly been firmly confirmed. And that was it for Day in the Life of an Ancient Egyptian Slave. Make sure you like and subscribe to the channel, or you might just turn into a Shabti yourself. And also, click the video in screen now to keep learning more about ancient civilizations.